When Sita saw this deer, she was like, ooh, shiny, I want it.
Hi everybody, welcome back to my channel. My name is Liana if you're new, and welcome to episode 20 of Makeup and Mythology, a series on my channel where I do my makeup and also tell you an ancient myth. So in last week's episode, we covered the Epic of Gilgamesh, the story of Gilgamesh, the tyrant king, and how his best friend died and that made him want to be immortal because he was like, wow, dying looks like it sucks, so I don't really want to do that. This week we are covering the Ramayana, an ancient Indian epic poem, which tells the story of a prince named Rama. So without further ado, let's get started. Once there was a king, Dasaratha, who was childless, and he really wanted a son to pass on his throne to. So he asks his mentor for help. I mean, if you want a baby, just... But I guess everybody has their own way of doing things. And so he goes to his mentor, and his mentor is like, okay, so I saw a vision in which all the gods were conferencing and appealing to Vishnu. And Vishnu, if you remember from my Kamadeva episode, is one of the three supreme Hindu gods that are responsible for creating, maintaining, and destroying the world. The other two of which are Brahma and Shiva. So Vishnu, super powerful, super important. So in the mentor's vision, the gods were talking about defeating Ravana, a demon king who uses his powers for evil. And Vishnu said, okay, look, I'll go down there myself. I'll go be a human and I'll take care of this demon king. And so King Dasaratha's mentor is like, okay, your majesty, this is your chance. Vishnu's trying to come down to the mortal realm, so you need to get his attention. Have a sage conduct a sacrifice to Vishnu. So he does exactly that. And after the sacrifice, Dasaratha's three wives all became pregnant with sons. So Kausalya gives birth to Rama. Kaikeyi, Dasaratha's favorite wife, and you'll see why this is important later, gives birth to Bharata. And Sumitra gives birth to the twins Lakshmana and Shatrughna. Prince Rama grew up to be handsome, strong, wise, and pious. Everything you would want in a man. Or at least the princess Sita thought so. One day Rama went to a neighboring city on business, and the princess fell in love with him, so they got hitched. Some time passed, everything was fine and dandy, and King Dasaratha realized he was getting old, so he named Rama as his successor. Everybody's happy about Rama ascending the throne, except for a woman named Kuni, who was Kaikeyi's close friend, Kaikeyi being the king's favorite wife. Kuni was a hunchback woman, and in his youth, Rama would make fun of her deformity and throw clay balls at her, and she decided that she would hold this grudge for the rest of her life and do everything in her power to destroy Rama. So Kuni manages to convince Kaikeyi that Rama will treat her badly if he's crowned king. So that night, when Dasaratha came to her bedroom, Kaikeyi is like, hey babe, remember years ago you promised me two favors, whatever I wanted? I'd like to cash them in now. And Dasaratha was like, sure my love, what would you like? And she goes, I want you to banish Rama to the jungle for 14 years, and I want you to make my son, Bharata, the king. And because Dasaratha is a simp, he's like, fuck, I don't want to, but I promised. So he actually does it, and Rama is exiled. And then Dasaratha dies of grief, or old age, I don't know, he was really old. Maybe he shouldn't have promised her literally anything she wanted. Guys promise all kinds of shit when they're horny. Absolutely helpless. So upon hearing the news of Rama's exile, Sita, his princess, was like, aw man, you got exiled? Alright, I guess I'm gonna come with, because I love you. And Rama was like, no, stay home, don't come. And she was like, I wanna come. So she came. And not only that, one of Rama's brothers, Lakshmana, was like, I wanna come too. This dude volunteered to be a third wheel just for the sake of brotherhood. I guess that's pretty cool of him. Very wholesome. So the three of them went into the jungle together, and on their journey, they came across a couple interesting characters. They came across the poet Valmiki, who promised to write a glorious epic about them called the Ramayana, which actually came to be known as one of the two major Sanskrit epics of ancient India. And they also came across a holy hermit who gave Rama a divine bow and arrow. Eventually, Rama, Sita, and Lakshmana arrived at the barbaric southern jungles of India, a place inhabited by the Rakshas, who were magical, savage, demon people. They came across a great eagle named Jatayu, who said that he was Dasaratha's friend and would do what he could to protect them. Rama and his brother Lakshmana built themselves a home in an open meadow, and things were fine and dandy there for a while. Until one day, a Raksha maiden, Sorpanaka, saw Rama and fell in love with him. And even though she was beautiful, she was hot, she was thick, he swerved her advances. And she was like, God damn it, maybe if I murder his wife, he'll pay attention to me. So she sprang at Sita to kill her.
and thankfully Rama and Lakshmana managed to protect her. Lakshmana then cut off Sorpanaka's nose, ears, and breasts. Boy, he cut off her titties. Don't mess with a girl's titties, that's fucked up. But yeah, she got disfigured and she went home. Turns out Sorpanaka was the Raksha princess, and her brother, Ravana, was the king of the Rakshas. And so she told her brother, yeah, this guy rejected me and his brother disfigured me, but you know who I'm really mad at? I'm mad at the guy's wife. She's pretty, and that pisses me off. Hey, maybe you should kidnap her and take her for yourself. And Ravana was like, she's pretty, huh? Let's see what all the fuss is about. So Ravana transformed his uncle Maricha into a golden deer, or in some versions, a jeweled, bedazzled one. Maricha was just not here for it, but Ravana threatened him, so what else could he do? Ravana then released Maricha into the jungle and sent him as bait. When Sita saw this deer, she was like, ooh, shiny, I want it. Lakshmana and Rama were like, no, Sita, that's really sus. Can't you see it's so sus? Why is there a random, beautiful deer in the middle of this jungle? And she was like, no, I don't give a fuck, I want the shiny deer. So of course, Rama was like, fine, you know, the missus wants it, I'm gonna go get it. So he went alone into the depths of the jungle to chase this deer. And he found it, and he shot it, and as it died, it cried out for help with a perfect imitation of Rama's voice. Clever. So Lakshmana was already really suspicious of this deer, so he was like, I don't know, I think Rama should be fine, you know, like we did just hear his voice call out for help, but it should be fine, should be fine. But Sita was like, oh my god, that was Rama calling out for help. Lakshmana, go check on him, please, go. So Lakshmana was like, okay, fine, and he left. And so Sita was all by herself now, and Ravana showed up and kidnapped Sita in his flying chariot. I think across the past 20 episodes of Makeup and Mythology, this is the second instance of kidnapping via chariot. We're starting to see some commonalities now. So if you remember Jatayu, Dasaratha's eagle friend, he tried to rescue her as Ravana was kidnapping her, but Ravana cut off one of his wings. R.I.P. Definitely a goner. So anyway, in the depths of the forest, Lakshmana met up with Rama, and of course he was fine. And they went home to find Sita gone. The men had no idea what happened to her until the dying Jatayu told them that Ravana had kidnapped her. But before he could tell them where they went, he died. So the two brothers set out to look for Sita. And on their journey, they came to be in a place called Kiskinda, a place inhabited by monkeys. And they came across a monkey king and his advisor, who had been banished by the monkey king's brother. So in order to get the monkey king's help, they decided to take a little detour and defeated the monkey king's brother and reestablish the monkey king on his throne just real quick, you know, barely took any effort. And to thank them, the monkey king sent his monkeys to all parts of India to find Sita for them. The bravest monkey found her on the island of Ceylon, and she was a prisoner in Ravana's palace. Yeah, she was literally in the palace of the guy who kidnapped her. Who would have thought? Unless Ravana had multiple palaces and it would have been confusing or something. I don't know. India's a big place. But anyway, Rama vowed to destroy Ravana, and he went to the ocean to try to get to the island. So at this point, one might think, you know, he might try to build like a raft or like a canoe or like a boat or some shit, right? Wrong. Rama was like, fuck it, I'm gonna shoot arrows into the ocean, or like into the sky, or whatever, because remember he had that divine bow and arrow? It wasn't a regular bow and arrow, it was divine. So he decided to shoot a bunch of divine arrows and create some turbulence and some storms, and the ocean was like, okay, okay, dude, relax, you could have just asked. Go talk to the god Nala. And Rama was like, okay, thank you, ocean. Nala was an architect, an engineer, and he instructed the monkeys to build a golden bridge of boulders and trees over to Ceylon. In 5 days, the bridge was completed, and Lakshmana and the army of monkeys crossed it to meet Ravana and the other demons in battle. They fought for days, lots of monkeys died, and just as it was looking real bad for Team Rama, Rama managed to slay Ravana with his holy arrow, and the gods were very pleased. And it was revealed to everybody that Rama was the incarnation of Vishnu, and Rama was just him assuming an earthly form to carry out the task of destroying the demon Rakshas and freeing the world from evil. When the freed Sita approached Rama, he was like, hey babe, nice to see you. I can't take you back because I'm pretty sure you had sex with the demon king while you were in there, and you're used goods, so I don't want to take you back. You know, it's weird. And plus, you know, I'm a god. You know, gods and mortals shouldn't really be together anyway, so. Sita, of course, was devastated that her husband rejected her, so she was like, build me a funeral pyre. I'm gonna kill myself. Okay, so this is the second occurrence of somebody building their own funeral pyre in the past 20 episodes of this series.
Let me know down in the comments if you remember which story the first occurrence was from.
So yeah, Sita, devastated and prepared to die, walked into the flames. However, the flames didn't even singe her, and her miraculous fireproofness actually proved her innocence during her imprisonment.
She literally survived because she didn't get any of that demon dick.
Well, lucky for her, because after Rama saw that, he was like, "All right, I guess you can be my wife again."
Okay, I hated that. Anybody else?
Anyway, after that, Rama asked Indra, the thunder god, to revive all the dead monkeys, and he did. So that's great for the monkeys. That's actually pretty wholesome. And then the gods told Rama that his brother, Bharatha, would actually kill himself if he didn't go back to the kingdom. So the gods magicked him back to his father's kingdom, and he ascended the throne, just like he was meant to do. So Rama and Sita became king and queen. Eventually, Sita, who was now queen, had a dream in which a god entered her womb in the form of a small white elephant, and the heavens sang for joy. And the wise men of the palace interpreted this as meaning her son would become a great saint or great king. And indeed, after some time, she gave birth to a boy named Siddhartha Gautama, aka Buddha. Yep, the Buddha. But that's a story for another day. So that's pretty much it for today's episode. I definitely presented a very summarized version of the story, because if I got down and dirty into the intricate details of this entire epic poem, then this video would be a lot longer. But in doing research for this video, I did come across several sources that were very, very detailed, and it was also fascinating to read. So if you are interested, definitely feel free to do further research on your own. Of course, I'm just a girl doing her makeup on the internet. I'm no historian, so it is entirely possible for me to miss a couple details or get some things wrong every once in a while, but I am trying my best to be as accurate as I possibly can be when it comes to relaying these ancient myths, especially when it comes to religious texts. I don't want to be disrespectful or inaccurate. The main goal of this series is to learn about other cultures, definitely not to be disrespectful in any way, so hopefully it doesn't come off that way. You know, if I ever get anything wrong, feel free to let me know. So with that said, I hope you enjoyed today's episode. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!